Hi, I'm Shashank Bhargav, and you're listening to Three Things, the Indian Express news show. On Tuesday, the Delhi High Court granted bail to three student activists, Devangana Kalita, Natasha Narwal, and Asif Iqbal Tana, after them having spent more than a year in jail. These three people have been accused by the Delhi police of conspiracy to plan riots and destabilize the government in the guise of anti-CAA and anti-NRC protests. All three have been booked under the stringent UAPA Act for it. UAPA, or Unlawful Activities Prevention Act, is an anti-terrorism law, but is often misused against individuals dissenting against the government. It is very hard to get bail when you are booked under this act. This is one of the reasons why the court granting them bail is a big deal. Now, while passing the orders for it, the court also raised serious concerns regarding the case that has been made out against them by the Delhi police. It also talked about how UAPA is being misused here and even pulled up the special court that had previously denied bail to these three students. In this episode, we will talk about what the court said in its orders. We will also take a quick look at how the parents of these students have reacted to this decision. And then finally, we will talk about the significance of this order as far as UAPA cases are concerned, and whether it will impact them in the future. For this, we start by talking to Anand Mohan, who reports on Delhi courts for the Indian Express. Anand, before we talk about the order itself, could you just refresh the memory of our listeners and talk a bit about the Delhi riots themselves?
Yeah, so the Delhi riots took place in the month of February in the year 2020. 53 people died during these riots, which took place over a 2 to 3 day period when the US President Donald Trump had come to visit India. In the backdrop of it, if you want to understand what had happened, which led to this explosion of violence, was that there were agitations against the CAA, NRC, which had been taking place all over the country. And in Delhi, in several parts of Northeast Delhi, where this violence took place, also there were sit-ins which had been going on for quite some time. Tensions rose after BJP leader Kapil Mishra turned up and he said that this sort of chakka jam was causing inconvenience and if these people will not leave, then we'll take matter into our own hands. Eventually, over the next few days, violence ratcheted up between different communities, different localities, and this went on for 3 days. And currently, the main case which is arising from this is the PA case, which relates to the special cell of the Delhi police investigating what was the larger conspiracy behind the Delhi riots.
And it is this conspiracy under which a number of student activists have been booked. And this included Natasha Narwal, Devangana Kalita and Asif Iqbal Tana, who on Tuesday were granted bail. So could you talk about who these students are and what exactly are the charges against them?
Yeah, so Devangana Kalita and Natasha Narwal are PhD candidates at JNU. They're a part of a women's rights group called the Pinjra Tod, and they're also part of other activist groups. Among them are Delhi Protest Support Group and the Jamia Coordination Committee, this group called Auraton Ka Inqilab. And the Delhi police allegation is that both of them are a part of the larger conspiracy. The main allegations against these two women are that they instigated the local population in certain Muslim-dominated areas of Delhi. They incited several women among them, which eventually led to violence and rioting. So Kalita is facing trial in 4 cases and Narwal in 3. Currently, they've been granted bail in all cases. Tanha, on the other hand, is a Jamia Millia Islamia University student, and he's accused in this case and is accused in a previous case, which stems from a Jamia riots investigation, which was investigated by the crime branch of the Delhi police. Now, in this particular case, the UAPA case, the police have said that he was a member of a WhatsApp group called Jamia Coordination Committee, which was basically formed to protest against the CAA. The only allegation against him, which even the High Court had noted in its order, was the fact that there was just a SIM card that he had given to a co-accused person. The police very largely have also accused him of trying to mobilize Muslims and especially imams and trying to mobilize the riots. Now, all of them have been charged under sections 15, 17 and 18 of the UAPA, which deals with what is a terrorist activity and what are the various provisions for punishment for raising funds for a terrorist act and for a conspiracy.
Right, and they were first booked more than a year back for it. Since then, they have spent time in jail. And now, obviously, the High Court has given them bail. But could you talk about their previous attempts to get bail and the reasons that they were rejected?
So their bails were rejected by a special court headed by additional sessions judge Amitabh Rawat. So ASJ Rawat had rejected Tanha's bail by taking note of the fact that even though Tanha is not part of, let's say, a terrorist organization, but we still have to understand terrorist activity as per the provisions of the act. So the judge went through the provisions of the act and said that vociferous agitation in the guise of the citizenship amendment bill, coupled with various other activities of violence, would show that the Tanha's actions would try to cause this affection to India. So just a very simple reading of Section 15, and the court said that this qualifies under UAPA, so you know that we can't give him bail. Now, in case of Natasha Narwal and Kalita, their lawyers had been arguing that asking the prosecution to produce one video to show that they had made any sort of hate speech or caused disaffection towards the country. So in this case, the court had held that not having a video was not so vital, as generally conspiracy by its very nature is hatched in secrecy. Now, these were some of the observations which the court had flagged while rejecting their bails. But I must tell you that it is extremely difficult to secure bail in a UAPA case, because there are certain provisions which have been inbuilt into the UAPA, which makes it very difficult to secure bail. But what has happened, what has changed, is that the High Court said that the allegations pertaining to Sections 15, which is the Terrorist Act, punishment for raising funds for Terrorist Act, and punishment for conspiracy of the UAPA, they were not really made out by the subject matter in the charge sheet, or state had tried to convince the court that these charges stick, but the court said that there's not much in terms of evidence to go with that. So they said that since these, the allegations against the accused as per the charge sheet and as per what the prosecution is saying, they do not prima facie disclose commission of any of these offenses under the UAPA, the court said that so the additional conditions, limitations or restrictions on the grant of bail in the UAPA do not hold. So that is what had changed this time around.
Right. And you know, the court, while giving them bail, also raised serious concerns about the case and the charges that have been made out against them. So could you talk about what the court said about the case overall?
So if you just look at what the High Court has said on just on the charge sheet and what the Delhi police case is, they've said that the state is basically just relying on stretched inferences and alarming and hyperbolic verbiage. The High Court has very clearly said that the allegations relating to inflammatory speeches, organizing a chakka jam, instigating women, stockpiling of various articles, at worst is just an evidence of participation in organizing a protest. If you just look at what the court had to say about Kalita and Narwal, is the fact that the allegations of against them are not borne out from the material in hand. So basically nothing in the charge sheet which says that these allegations stick. When it comes to Tanha's bail order, the court has said that there is no allegation whatsoever in the charge sheet that he was leading these co-conspirators or had formed the JCC, this WhatsApp group, or was even the administrator of any WhatsApp group. And the court said that even if he was a member of these groups, it is not a banned organization or a terrorist organization which has been listed in the first schedule of the UAPA. Court also rejected this police allegation that Tanha was under instructions to visit Muslim areas to coordinate with local imams and all. And the court also said that there is no allegation of any recovery of arms or ammunition. So the court said that there was absolutely nothing in the charge sheet to show the commission of a terrorist act. So this is very important. So the court has perused the charge sheet in great detail. It has charge sheets around 17,000 pages long, and the court has gone through it and it has said that there's absolutely no evidence whatsoever to substantiate allegations of terrorist activity.
And the court in this order has also talked about three different aspects. It talked about the UAPA law specifically. It also pulled up the special court and it talked about the right to protest. So let's start with UAPA first. What has the court said regarding it?
So when it comes to what the court had to say about the UAPA, they've made some very strong comments and it's clearly called out the misuse of the UAPA by the state in this order. That much is very clear. The court has held that terrorist activity cannot be broadly defined to include ordinary penal offenses, right? So the High Court also took note of the fact that the state took great pains to argue this fact that Section 15, which describes what a terrorist activity is, under its ambit, not only will an act with an intent to threaten the foundations of a nation, but also an act which is likely to threaten. So that's a big difference. One is that you've done some act which has threatened the unity of or whatever of this country. And then this other act, that there is an intention, that there is a likelihood that this person will commit. So the state was trying to argue that this fact that there is a likelihood that this would have led to much worse scenario should also be looked into the ambit of a terrorist activity. But the court considered this and said that this aspect of likelihood of threat and terror The foundations of our nation stand on surer footing than to be likely shaken up by a protest. So this is a very important observation made by the High Court. The High Court also said that foisting these extremely grave and serious penal provisions frivolously upon people would undermine the intent and purpose of the parliament in enacting a law. And this law was enacted for the defense of India. So this is what the court had to say about the UAPA in general.
Okay, and the other thing that the court did was pull up the special court that had earlier denied bail to these three activists. So what are the things that the court said that the special court should have done?
So the special court, like we've said in the start of our discussion, had rejected the bail pleas of these three student activists. Now there is a common order through which this additional sessions judge Amitabh Rawat had rejected the bail pleas of Kalita and Narwal. So the court went through that and they figured out that what happens in these cases is that an independent authority looks at the evidence which has been collected by the police and submits a report saying whether or not the sections of UAPA are attracted in this case or not. The court has to consider that, and the court, after considering that, if it thinks that, okay, that if the committee thinks that, yes, the UAPA is attracted, then the court will go with it. Interestingly, this committee is appointed by the central government. Now, what the High Court has said is that the special court just did not apply its own independent mind. There was just no critical analysis of the evidence. It just went with whatever was there in the subject matter of the charge sheet. And it also said that these special courts cannot just accept a report blindly and then not use its own mind. It must use its own mind because these are very serious provisions. So that's how the special court, which rejected the bail pleas of Narwal and Kalita, was pulled up by the High Court.
Okay, so the court talked about the misuse of the UAPA by the state and why it shouldn't be used in such a broad manner. And it also pulled up the special court, saying that it should apply its own independent mind when looking at such cases. Now, apart from this, the court also emphasized one's right to protest. So what are the things that stand out in the order regarding protesting?
So the Delhi High Court has again in its order stressed the importance of the right to protest in this country. The High Court has relied on a slew of Supreme Court judgments to state that protests against the government and parliamentary actions are legitimate. That is number one. The second thing is that the High Court has also accepted that it is not uncommon for protesters to push the limits permissible in law. So this is very important. The second thing is that, as we have discussed, that when the court went through the allegations against these two women, it just said that most of these allegations look like they just organized the protest and there's nothing wrong with that. The court has made a very important observation in this, where it has said that in the mind of the state, the line between the constitutionally guaranteed right to protest and terrorist activity seems to be somewhat blurred. So this shows the High Court stand on the importance of the right to protest in this country.
Now, these three student activists, like mentioned earlier, have spent more than a year in jail. Natasha Narwal's father, in fact, passed away while she was in jail, but she still couldn't get bail. So the news of them finally getting bail came as a huge relief to their parents. Indian Express's Aranya Shankar spoke to the families of these students, and she tells us how they have reacted.
So I think one major reaction, of course, is a lot of happiness and excitement, because I think considering that they were all booked under the UAPA, not many were expecting them to get the bail. As Devangana's mother, Kalpana Kalita, said that UAPA bail is an exception, it's not the rule. So they had always heard that, and she said that I had prepared Devangana that you're going to be in this for the long haul, and we had also prepared ourselves that this is going to be a long fight. So they were very surprised also, on the other hand, that they've got this bail. But I think there's also a sense of like caution about how Natasha's brother, for example, Akash, said, for example, that we wanted to celebrate them. Like the moment we heard it, everyone in the family, extended family, was very happy. But we thought, let's wait till she actually reaches home. So there's also that apprehension a little bit, whether this bail will actually materialize, whether these people will be let off. Obviously, the predominant feeling is a major sense of relief and also just happiness that after more than a year, these people will be now let out of jail. Asif, of course, because his final year exams, has been allowed to go out of jail just to give those exams. But in the sense that you've got bail under UAPA, it's a major victory. And Devangana's mother said that the bail order is a victory of democracy.
And Aranya, just talking about Natasha, for example, she had asked for bail while her father was unwell, and he passed away while she was in jail. She, of course, later got bail for doing his last rites. So could you talk about what this time has been like for her and her family?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, in hindsight now, it seems like it was just a matter of a month. If she had just got that bail a month earlier, she would have been able to meet her father for the last time. It's been an incredibly difficult time, both, I'm sure, for her to have been let out at that time on bail after a whole year just to cremate her father, and then she was out for 3 weeks maybe, and then go back to jail. And her father was the person who was fighting this case. He was a very politically, socially determined man. He with her through the end. He would come to Delhi, travel for every court hearing. Devangana's parents have said on umpteen occasions that they drew their strength from him, because even when they felt they're stressed or nervous or they don't know what will happen, they're feeling anxious about the future, they would draw their strength from him. So he was sort of the central figure in all of this, guiding everyone. And Natasha had lost her mother at a very young age. You know, it's been a long time. He was the only sort of parental, but also a friend figure for her to kind of lean on and do this. And now the only person left in her immediate family is her younger brother. Naturally, he's not as experienced. He doesn't know how to handle this. And now all of that responsibility has fallen on him as the sole person of family. So he also said yesterday that while we are all very happy, I can't help but feel that I wish my father was alive and he could have just met her once. So there is that feeling that has sort of a little bit dampened the whole excitement of the bail.
Now, even though the court granted bail to them on Tuesday morning, till at least Wednesday night, they were still in jail. The Delhi police told the city court that they needed time to conduct address verification of the accused and their sureties. And it is also important to note that the Delhi police has approached the Supreme Court against the Delhi High Court's order. But even so, the court's order, especially what it said about the UAPA law, is significant. And to talk about it and how it can affect other UAPA cases in the future, we speak to Apurva Vishwanath, who reports on law for the newspaper. Apurva, when giving bail to these three student activists, the Delhi High Court talked about how UAPA should not be used. It said that ordinary penal offences cannot be defined as terrorist acts and said that the law should not be applied this broadly. Now, UAPA, of course, has in the past been used broadly and it is often subject to misuse. So considering that, what significance does the Delhi High Court saying this have?
So the UAPA creates an alternate criminal justice system where the Code of Criminal Procedure, CRPC, as we understand, does not apply as a safeguard. So CRPC is the procedural safeguards that are built into the criminal justice system. So when UAPA then gives the state special powers, it gives them more time to file charge sheets. It makes bail conditions very stringent. So the state has a lot of power in how they can handle the accused, conduct the trial. Even for the course of investigation, the state has a lot of powers compared to what they would get under ordinary laws, that is the IPC and the CRPC. So this is why UAPA is used more widely these days. In Jammu and Kashmir, for example, UAPA was slapped against those who were using proxy servers to access social media, for example. Or take the case of tribals in Chhattisgarh. So UAPA is being used in cases which are not the traditional definition of terrorism as we understand. So what this Delhi High Court order does is, in all three orders, but specifically the judge talks about this in the main order, which is Iqbal Thana's bail order. The judge says that UAPA was designed for handling terror-related cases. So where is the aspect of terrorism in these cases? So he says that simply because there was violence, simply because that violence caused death of somebody, you can't label it a terror case. For it to be a terror case, it has to be distinguished from ordinary cases that can be covered under the IPC. Basically, the judge places a very high bar for the state to slap a terror case under UAPA against anyone.
And when we talk about this case, how exactly has the Delhi police interpreted and used UAPA against these student activists?
So Section 15 of the UAPA is what defines a terrorist act. And the conditions in Section 15 say that an act that is with an intent to threaten the unity and integrity of India the intent to strike terror or the likelihood to strike terror with or without the use of firearms. But there's also another line which says causing or likely to cause not just death, but injuries to any person or loss of damage to property and so on. So the Delhi police was basically reading section 15 by placing emphasis on the last bit, which said causing or likely to cause death or injuries or destruction of property. Whereas the court refused this interpretation and the court basically said that you have to read that as a whole. That is A and B parts of the provision, which is threaten the unity and integrity of India or the intent to strike terror, when they are sort of fulfilled, then the third aspect of causing death or injuries will come into play. Just because an act can cause death or injuries doesn't mean it's a terrorist act. It should have the intent to strike terror. That's what the Delhi High Court essentially says.
Yeah, because if you just look at the second part, that could be any criminal offense, right? Where one person wants to just harm another.
Absolutely. Just because, you know, you don't want to file charges under the IPC, but under a special law that gives the state more powers, doesn't mean the state should be allowed to do that. But on the contrary, if something can be dealt under IPC, should be dealt under IPC and not under the UAPA.
And so considering this ruling and the courts saying this, how does it affect the case against these three students?
So one is that now that they've been given bail, and the reason for the grant of bail is, the Delhi High Court says, is because terror charges against them prima facie don't apply. So in every standard bail order, there's a line which says all the observations in this should not impact the trial. Having said that, even when the High Court says that in writing, it is definitely a stronger case for these three student activists when they are facing trial because the charges are not made out against them. So it obviously will aid them in the trial, despite the High Court's caution that this shouldn't be taken on as an observation on merit for the trial.
And will this order affect other UAPA cases, say future cases where UAPA might be used against someone?
So why these three bail orders are sort of monumental? Because getting bail under UAPA is extremely difficult, virtually impossible. But the Delhi High Court has shown that it can be done. Section 43 of the UAPA basically says that any court, it just has to be satisfied that prima facie there is a case against the accused and that prima facie satisfaction is enough to deny bail. So in 2019, a Supreme Court verdict in the case of Vatali also said that while granting bail or to grant bail, a judge doesn't even have to look into the merit of the evidence. So there could be evidence that is very flimsy, but the judge shouldn't look into the content of the evidence and should just be satisfied that there is a prima facie case. So this made getting bail even more difficult. The slight relief came in February this year, where again, a two-judge bench of the Supreme Court led by Chief Justice Ramana and Justice Suryakant, that ruling said that it created a bit of a leeway and said that if the trial is likely to go on for a very long time, then the accused can be granted bail under UAPA. So all of these made getting bail almost impossible. But what the Delhi High Court does here is sort of say, if there is a prima facie case, then bail can be denied or bail has to be denied. But they put the onus on the police to bring a prima facie case. So instead of the judge going on a fishing expedition, trying to connect the dots and figure out if there is a prima facie case, the Delhi High Court says the police should show us one. What is on record should speak for itself. And if a prima facie case is presented, then bail can be denied. But in this case, the judge again finds that the Delhi police has no material on record that shows individual culpable acts of these three student activists. In fact, the only act of omission or commission specifically to them that the Delhi High Court has found is in the case of Iqbal Tana, and that is an offense or an act where he passed on a SIM card to somebody else. That is the only act commission that the Delhi High Court has found in all three orders.
Okay, so let's say in the future someone, say even the Delhi police, uses UAPA against someone for protesting. What would stop someone from being booked under those charges? Like, what system in place would stop that from happening based on these orders?
you know, looking back at our experience with the sedition law under the IPC, you have a Supreme Court verdict which says that this law can be applied only in these limited circumstances. Yet you see the weaponization of sedition again and again. The same happens with UAPA. But the difference is, once the case has been filed, sort of, in case of sedition, because the law is so clear, it becomes easy, or it becomes regular practice for a trial court judge or the high courts to grant bail and act as a safeguard against potential misuse of the law. In case of UAPA, because the Supreme Court ruling and the law itself had made granting of bail so difficult, it would almost be impossible for a trial court to grant bail. They would have to take the state's word at face value in many, many of these cases. Many scholars have noted this trend of an informal plea bargain happen in UAPA cases, because you will spend your time in jail till you are acquitted or convicted. So the accused would also enter into a bargain with the prosecution, where they would agree to the crimes which they may or may not have committed, and would serve the sentence that they've already served in jail, which means after the conviction, the sentence will say punishment for what you've already served as an under trial. So no fresh jail term would be given to them. So UAPA, where the process would become the punishment, rulings like these act as a safeguard. If when the state misuses, the courts step in and do their job. And another thing that Delhi High Court bail orders do is give some impetus to a trial court judge to ask questions of the state, to ask the state to show the terrorism from the material on record. So is there cross-border funding? You know, there are many layers to what can be constituted as terrorism. So it basically emboldens the trial court judge to ask these questions and decide whether UAPA charge can be made out or not.
You are listening to Three Things by The Indian Express. Today's show was written and produced by me, Shashank Bhargav, and was edited and mixed by Suresh Pawar. If you like the show, then do subscribe to us wherever you get your podcasts. You can also recommend the show to someone you think will like it, share it with a friend or someone in your family. It's the best way for people to get to know about us. You can tweet us at Express Podcasts and write to us at podcasts@indianexpress.com.